Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
You can't win.
Are you ready?
It's like playing checkers. No, it's like playing Pokemon. When Benjamin was 6 years old, he used to play.
Good evening, everyone. Before we start the meeting, I'm going to ask Vice Chair Bill Lashley to offer the invocation and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to give you thanks for this day and all the many blessings you share with us this day. We ask for your guidance in everything we say and do this evening. We ask you to give us energy and strength to do what the people have us to do. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
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 Of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Bill. This time we'll call the meeting to order. Welcome to all of you. Appreciate you coming out on this wonderful weather we're having tonight evening. We're glad you're here. We will first entertain public comments. We have one tonight. I'd like to call Mr. Eddie Hsu. Eddie, welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Commissioners, y'all keep asking for guidance. If it's possible, I begin to doubt the board because he don't seem to be guiding you sometimes. So, kind of worries me. I'm here about the consolidating the boards. That makes no sense for the citizens. This board, if you've been here and listened a long time, you have heard some members of the board that are open and hostile to these two board heads. This morning, Commissioner Sutton made a statement, and I paraphrase, that he'd only be interested in y'all getting the ability to hire and fire the heads. Do anything other than that, he didn't care about day-to-day running. So with those kind of attitudes on the board, and I wish he was here, he could tell you exactly what he said, I don't see where it benefits the county to be getting into their business over there. I know I come up here, I sound like I'm always on a level of junk. I'm just on being right, being fair, and because I certainly, there's a lot of things that goes on in those departments. I said, well, I don't see why we spend the money for that. I don't understand. It doesn't make sense to me. But to make the situation worse by injecting politics into it, which is what this will come down to for this and future boards, every time you have a change in power, there's going to be people that has a different view. You know, there might be all Democrats next time, and they want to hire somebody real liberal, you know. I mean, so why get the politics in it? They do a fair job, don't hear a lot of complaints. Frankly, they're mandated so much that I don't see where they can do a lot before, you know, of other things. That's basically all I want to say. Just don't stick to politics in it. Leave it. You know, if they ain't broke, don't fix it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I should have mentioned before we started, Commissioner Sutton is not with us tonight because he's teaching a class. I think he's been briefed on tonight's agenda. Trying to get, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
At this time, before we formally approve the agenda, are there any commissioner responses? If not, let's take a minute and review the agenda for consideration of approval. If we do approve the agenda, it would also include the items on the consent agenda. Mr. Trinicut, do you have any changes to the agenda that you'd like to propose?
No, sir.
Okay. After review of the agenda, including the items under the consent agenda, is there a motion to approve that agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Bill and David. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The approval of the agenda is passed along with the consent agenda. Next item. Presentation of the public hearing and approval of the 2012-2013 secondary road construction program. I'd like to invite and welcome Mr. Mike Mills, who is our Area Division Engineer for North Carolina Division Transportation, right?
That's it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mike, welcome.
Thank you. I do have with me today, or tonight, Chuck Edwards. He is our local district engineer for Alamance and Orange Counties. So a lot of this stuff we see on the program, Chuck will be responsible for making sure it's completed in a timely manner. You do have in front of you our program and map. I would like to point out there is a small error in our allocation. There's a penny off, so if you want to just change the 2012-13 allocation, just round it up to $776,896. We have completed most of our unpaved roads in Alamance County. There's only about six or seven left. Most of those have one house on them, so we're still choosing to go and try to do some paved road improvements instead of doing some paving of more or less driveways, spending money on an individual house. So you won't see anything on the first page, which is normally our going from an unpaved road to a paved road. If you turn the page, on page two, you'll see our paved road improvements. And we've got a couple roads there. We're planning on constructing some turn lanes, the intersection of SR 1148, which is Anthony Road, and SR 1157, which is White Kennel Road, for a cost of $215,000. The next one is we're going to widen existing lanes and resurface SR 1157, which is White Kennel Road, from NC 49 back to SR 1148, Anthony Road. And then lastly, we're going to widen existing lanes and resurface SR 1148, Anthony Road, from NC 49 to SR 1157, White Kennel Road. We're partially funding that one. It'll take about another $195,000, $200,000 to complete the resurfacing of that. We'll do that after July 1. With maybe some resurfacing dollars. I'll come back to you to complete this resurfacing at a later date. You will notice on your map where these roads are located. They're all in one particular area. We're trying to anticipate some new development going on in that area. So we're trying to strengthen and put the turn lanes down in there. Everybody see on your map?
Yep.
All righty. So the paved road improvements totals about $662,000. On the very bottom of the page, you'll see something, road additions. This has been on the books for many, many, many years, probably since about 1970s or 80s. We're now in a position that we can do a little maintenance on those roads down there to bring these roads up to very minimal state maintenance standards. And I will go through that list right now. This is up in the Lakeview Estate subdivision up in Northern Alamance County. The first one is Lakeview Drive. It's from Sandy Cross Road to Woodbrook Drive. And that we're proposing doing some minimal road improvements necessary to meet a paved road standard. Now that section is still paved, believe it or not. It's not in the best of shape, but we're going to try to patch it out. Keep it as a paved road. Then from Lakeview Road, Lakeview Drive, if you go from Woodbrook, where we just ended the pave, down to Setter Lane, that we're going to bring up to minimum unpaved standards. Lakeview Estates is an old subdivision recorded prior to 75, so we can take it over as an unpaved road. But since we can save the portion that's already paved, from Sandy Cross Road to Woodbrook, we're going to try to save that. So from Lakeview Drive from Woodbrook down to Setter will be an unpaved road standard. Then we go back up to Idlewild Avenue from Lakeview Drive to the dead end, perform minimum roadway improvements to meet minimum paved road standards for addition. Again, it is a paved road all right, that little short section. We're going to try to save that paved road. Turn the page. We're proposing on performing some maintenance on Wynwood Drive from Sandy Cross Road to Lakeview. We'll bring this section up to minimum unpaved road standards. Then Woodbrook Drive from Lakeview to the dead end, perform road improvements to meet minimum unpaved standards. And Setter Drive from Lakeview Drive to the dead end, perform road improvements necessary to meet minimum unpaved road standards. You will see that all of these have partial funding on them. What you see here in this on the column on the right-hand side is coming out of our secondary construction funds tonight. Board member Mike Fox, who wanted to come here tonight but had business taken away from here, he has agreed to fund the remaining portion, about $50,000. So we're trying to combine some funds to get enough to bring these roads up to at least minimum standards to bring them on the state system. This will not get every road in there. We just, there's not enough house counts to get everything around the lake, so we're doing the very best we can, get what we can on the state system. And for that, it's about $64,000. Again, Mike Fox, the board members agree to put up $50,000, so we got a little more than $100,000 going through these six roads in the Lakeview Estate subdivision. We are going to keep some funds for surveying, right-of-way acquisition, road additions, overdrafts, driveways to volunteer fire departments, etc., for a little more than $50,000 on that. So that does equal our total of $776,896. Mr. Chairman, that is our proposed secondary road program. Be glad to step aside and let the public say any comments if they choose to do so.
Thank you, Mike. This is now scheduled for a public hearing. I'd like to hear from anyone that would like to speak on this particular item. Also like to hear if there are any commissioner questions directed to our representatives tonight. Again, thank you both for being with us this evening. Do we have any folks on the left-hand side, my left, your right, that would like to speak on the presentation from Mr. Mills? Do we have any people on this side of the room that would like to speak on this presentation? Commissioner, comments or questions? Do I need to close the public hearing before we talk? I think I did.
Yes, you did.
At this time, then, we'll close the public hearing and seek responses and comments from the commissioners, either Mr. Mills or Mr. Edwards.
Well, I just want to thank Mike because I've been on his case for a while. Because I got him there on my case, been on my case for a long time at Lakeview trying to get these roads paved. So, and matter of fact, I called the guy and left him a message that finally we're going to get a little something done. It's not going to be what he wants, but.
Did he call you back?
Not yet. That was today after I was reading this. But I just want to thank you for what you've done, Mike.
Absolutely. So we've been out there many times. Chuck has been out there.
Wasn't that nice?
It's been on the books for a long time. I think it was back in the late 70s, early 80s when I first got involved with that, and nothing could be done at that time. And now we're in a position to try to help out if we can. And it's not going to be perfect. They're going to be on some unpaved roads, but we still got some across the county. At least it'll be an all-weather road.
But it's going to be gravel.
It's going to be gravel. You can at least get school buses down at post office, can deliver mail through there. I was down there about a year ago, and in some places I couldn't even drive my car through. I don't know how the folks got through. But our plan is, if the commissioners agree to it tonight, resolution support, it'll go to the board. Probably won't make the April board meeting, but it'll make the May board meeting. And once the board approves it in May, that does set free Chuck to go out there and start getting some of this stuff done.
Well, Jason Martin took me out there in the car, and I thought we was going to get in a hole and couldn't get out before we got out of there, because it was that bad.
It is bad.
So.
We do have a motion from Commissioner Smith. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Massey? The only question I have is, are we...
Excuse me.
Ms. Massey. What did I say? Commissioner Massey. I said
Commissioner
Massey.
Okay. I didn't hear that.
I won't tell you what all I've been called on this
show.
Are we at risk of any of this funding disappearing, or with the change, is Mike going to stay on? Is his term still on the DFU?
No, Mike, that's what he wanted to come down here tonight for. He was going to bring our new board member, Cheryl McCrary, is our new board member. So Mike is not staying on as the board for Division 7. Now, he will be here until the new board member, Cheryl, is sworn in, I believe, April 4th.
But are we at risk of losing any of
money? No, sir. No, this was really funds from last July 1st. So we're coming to you now with last year's funds. This is 2012 program. Right. We'll be coming to you again, hopefully after July 1st, with the new program. So this These funds are good.
We do have a motion and a second from Mrs. Massey. Is there any other question or discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Mike.
Thank y'all.
Edwards, thank you, sir. Next item, we have a grant application request for the Family Justice Center. I'd like to call on Cindy Brady, the director of the Family Justice Center. Cindy, good evening.
Good evening. Judge Jim Robertson is going to present on behalf of the Family Justice Center and the Victims Advocacy Council, and then I'm here to answer questions.
Thank you.
Judge, welcome.
Thank you. It's always a privilege to be here. Chairman, commissioners, I'm here on behalf of the advisory board of the Family Justice Center, which is, for your reference, is composed of every chief of police in Alamance County, plus the sheriff's department. And in the sheriff's actual absence, Mr. Britt, Chief Deputy Britt, is there. Members of the school system, members of Department of Social Services, judges, our Family Abuse Center, which services director, which is our private organization for advocacy. So it's a large group cross-section. And on behalf of the Victims Advocacy Council of Alamance, which is more of a brainstorming group that meets regularly also, which has a lot of these folks and more folks in the meeting to generate ideas that might help deal with the issue of domestic violence. So on behalf of all those, what I'm here to request is your approval to apply for a three-year grant for $300,000 from the Office of Violence Against Women. So I've kind of say again?
From where?
Office of Violence Against Women.
And what is that?
That is
a state, federal law?
That's a federal organization. It's just the it's a federal organization. It's in fact our first grant that was secured by our initial Family Justice Center director was from the Office of Violence Against Women. So it is a federal organization. There are several of them, and that's a big one that deals with.
Did it come under the Justice Department or what?
It comes under the Department of Justice. I know that's a point.
No.
But might be our opportunity to get something back from the Department of Justice. But the but it is a federal organization, so this is a federal grant. The ideas for it, our initial grant has expired now, and it's an idea is for us to dovetail and continue on with that that funding for that sort of thing. The county's involvement, I need to get right to the chase on this part. The county's involvement would be to be the fiscal agent, because it requires, this application requires a governmental unit that has taxing authority, not a taxing governmental unit, but a unit that has the authority to implement taxes and impose taxes. And so that limits the folks that we can ask to help us get this grant. In addition to that, the director of the Family Justice Center would be the one that would help facilitate the application for that grant, and would be the one that would be communicating with the fiscal agent to draw down funds for things that are needed. That's the only obligation that the county would have. We don't look for it to be sustained by hiring folks and having to hire them when the grant ends or other things of that nature. We're looking at a three-year opportunity, which we may or may not get, but we'd like to apply for a three-year opportunity that if we don't get it renewed, we've gotten 3 years worth of funds to help us with our county's domestic violence issues. So some of the highlights of what the system would entail sort of has to have a prologue or a preamble to it. We just didn't come up with these ideas out of thin air. We actually did surveys of law enforcement officers, victims, actually abusers, judges, and many others to see how we can continue to improve our domestic violence program in Alamance County. And I need to go ahead and brag, we are the leader in the state. And let me just parenthetically say this, y'all made a commitment to provide us with a family justice center. And as a part of that, we promised you that we would try to work on a system that allowed victims to stay at that family justice center and remotely file with the clerk's office and communicate with the judge's office. We believe that's going to take place this June at the expense of the state of North Carolina. No cost to the county of Alamance. It was a bumpy road to get there, but I just wanted you to know that that promise, we stayed on that promise because the Family Justice Center is a leader. And to show that that's something new, Wake County, what's the other county? At least Wake County wants to do what we're doing. They want to do what we're doing. And if when we do it in June, we'll be the first in the nation, the entire nation, to implement this. So I just needed to brag on you just a little bit. But the purpose of these additional funds would be to, if we're able to obtain the grant and if you approve our application to do so, would provide in-house on-site training for officers, for other people about this new electronic, you know, remote 50B domestic violence filing system, to develop a standard operating procedure amongst all the law enforcement agencies. I know as Chief Brett here refers to it as singing on the same page. And we're making efforts and we're making strides, but we're still having to do it. And it costs some funds because we have turnover in all these law enforcement agencies and we need regular training to make sure they're all singing from the same page. This is one thing. It has funds in the grant to hire a person, and that always pops up the flag. Hire a person to who is totally devoted to assisting victims of domestic violence in obtaining some of those emergency, immediate services, basic needs, whether it's access and protection, legal assistance, some immediate financial stability. After 3 years, if you know, this position would be covered by the funds in the grant. After 3 years, we wouldn't be asking the county to accept anything. Family Abuse Services has committed to try with this much lead time to work its budget to absorb this person. If we can't, then we can't. We had the advantage of it for 3 years. But the county would not be involved in absorbing any personnel out of this. It would also provide some dollars for housing assistance for immediate relief in those really dire emergency situations, provide law enforcement with ability to track texts and cell phones as a kind of a way to help protect victims. The Sheriff's Department, I understand, has that software. We're talking about software for the city of Burlington so it can help take some of the load off and kind of complement what the Sheriff's Department's doing right now. We've gotten assurances from the Burlington Police Department that if this works out the way it should, the Burlington Police Department will be, and the City of Burlington would be the folks that would look toward absorbing the cost of that in the future, not the county. So that's commitment from them. This would also help us coordinate victim safety and offender accountability through better prosecution, coordination with the district attorney's office, establish a system for us to have some case review and fatality review on these difficult cases. And something that we really have to work on is after hours services to victims. Right now, believe it or not, it's kind of limited to the number of hours, and this might allow us to expand it. Some of those issues are legislative in its basis, but nonetheless, that's where we are. So what we're here for today is I wanted to demonstrate to you that we're not asking the county to get on the hook for personnel, for longer expenses. We're asking for the privilege to apply for this grant and asking the county to be the fiscal agent and to, if you give us our approval, the Family Justice Center director would be the one that would work this up. One of the things I will go ahead and tell you is that the deadline is next week. It's one of those things with grants that it comes up late sometimes. I don't know how those things happen, but they do. But we have sort of been working on it in hopes of at least presenting it to you. And the application is, we'd be able to get that application in next week, with budget and all. Not sure we'll get the grant, but we've sure done a lot of things in Alamance County that justify us getting a continuation of that grant. And what we'd like to do is know whether we could have your approval to apply for that grant and allow the county to be a fiscal agent. So if you have questions, I'm glad to answer them. What I do generally is ask someone else to answer those for me. But if you have questions, I'm very happy to answer. I tried to address the issues that, I mean, we're all in a tough budget situation, I understand. And I tried to address the issues that sometimes raise when we have grant opportunities.
Is this a $300,000 grant a year, or?
No, sir, it's 3 years, $300,000 total. So it's roughly $100,000 a year.
How many employees do you have, Sandy? You're the only one.
Another big component in this that I didn't include is there's a growing need to address elder abuse. And while that's a little bit outside of our lane, as part of this consistent community response, we're going to incorporate some of those needs, because the reports have increased 50%, like, in the last 3 years. I mean, it's a huge growing, and we're seeing more people in our place over 70. There are folks that need attention, but they don't necessarily qualify for adult protective services. So that's another place we're going to use these grant funds to try to figure out some way to address that problem as well.
So what do you get people? I'm new. I don't know what the family justice center is. I may have heard of, but I don't know exactly what you do. Do you just direct them to counselors, and to, if they call you, to whatever police department they belong in, or what? I'm thinking about duplication of what Susan does. Are the duplications there?
We actually have a unit there in the Family Justice Center.
Oh, okay, so
it's streamlined pretty well. Mm-hmm. The Family Justice Center houses many of those services that folks are directed to, particularly family abuse services, which is on site now.
It's designed for one stop, right, so that victims can come to one place.
Okay, right. Coming
with
back
domestic violence.
That's right. So
you're being modest, Judge Smith. You were highly instrumental in us having an opportunity to have this Family Justice Center.
Well, I was.
but
I know it's a great opportunity here. I understand what your job is, and domestic violence is just unbelievable, not only in this county, but everywhere. So long as there's no duplication, then I don't have any problem with it at all.
The remote filing, are you talking about the electronic 50-bit filing?
Yes. We've convinced the state of North Carolina to pay for it. Yeah. They're going to roll it out statewide in some form or fashion.
Is that like they have on NCIS?
but it's much faster than NCIS can do it. It takes them an hour to do it.
So how many justice centers do we have in North Carolina now?
We're the only one of our kind, really. There's several different ones. It's one in Forsyth County.
And it's services.
Wake County.
And it's law enforcement, very heavily law enforcement.
It's not quite like ours, where we have the victim comes, victim stays. We have all these services revolve around the victim. It's pretty unique. But at most, we have a small handful. And we have people that are looking at us. We had Guilford County ask us to go over there and make a presentation.
They came
wrote
over
it
here
up.
Too.
And they came over here as well.
And Cumberland, they have one?
Cumberland has been here and looked at our model.
But I don't believe they have. It's kind of gratifying that we sort of lead in that regard. And the director of the administrative office of court, which is not like my boss, but kind of my boss, he's the head of my organization, the judicial system, came to meet with us by himself and have lunch with us and talk with us about this, and promised and has followed through with devoting a large amount of their services in their IT division to making this electronic 50B happen. And so it's just gratifying. They call and ask us questions. And we also tell them about the involvement of this county commission, Board of County Commissioners, that we could not have done it if we had not had a collaboration between the private and the public to provide us with the facility. You know well what I'm talking about, Mr. Chairman. It's a marvelous thing, and I'm going on too long, but it's just a marvelous thing, and we have a lot to be proud about in our county for what we do for victims of domestic violence. And that's what we're trying to do here, is address the continuation of those who came before us, and we're trying to build on what they've started.
I'll make the motion.
I second it.
Thank you, Dave. Linda? Any other question or discussions for either the judge or for Ms. Brady? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Good luck.
Thank you.
Let us know if
you get it. We'll report back with our success.
Thank you.
You.
Next item is a budget item, transfer of funds from the Capital Reserve for fire alarm replacement. Welcome, Brian Haygood, Assistant County Manager.
Good evening, Commissioners. If you'll recall, last fall we developed problems with the fire alarm system for the county office building and also for the civil courts building. The same system covers this building and the one next door. The system failed. It was inspected afterwards by Simplex Grinnell and found to be no longer operable. In fact, employees were walking fire watch for a number of weeks during the workday, as well as CCOM was walking fire watch after hours until we could get. We worked with Simplex to get the system up to just enough to a point where Grand Fire Marshal would allow us to no longer walk fire watch. However, the system does need to be replaced. We've worked with Allie Williams, Carmen, and King to get a design. This system had to be designed by an engineer for both buildings to come up with a new system that would be code compliant. After that design was complete and bids were taken, a company called Connect of Winston-Salem was selected as the low bidder. Their price for installing the system is $49,500. The design work and overseeing the installation of the system by Allie Williams will be an additional $25,000. We're requesting to be able to use the Capital Building Capital Reserve funds for this project. That money, we have to come before the board and request permission to be able to use it. The current balance in that fund is $108,175. If you approve this project, the new balance after the fire alarm project is paid for would be $33,675. So I'm here this evening to request that you approve this project and to answer any questions that you may have about it.
Questions for Brian? This is an action item.
Are you going to have to rip everything out that's here now, or are you going to build on what's already here?
It'll all have to be replaced. This system is original to the original construction of the building, and Dakota required it. We take it out. It's okay. And in fact, the new design, it will actually be two separate systems. The issue we had was it was difficult to walk fire watching the court side of the building because we were, you know, interrupting court business. But everything reported to one panel in this building, this new system. They will be together. We'll know if there's a fire on either side of the building, but if one side goes down, we can disable one side without doing the other. So
Does anybody monitor your information that's being collected?
Yes, sir. CCOM will monitor, saving us the annual monitoring fees, which is fantastic. Over time, that'll save us some money.
Did the fire marshal or the city of Graham say we had to do this, replace it?
Yes, he met with Mr. Honeycutt and our staff and walked through with Simplex Grinnell and looked at it, and I have a letter from him saying that the system is inoperable and needs to be replaced.
So we don't have much choice.
Unless we want to return to Firewatch.
Yeah. Sir, we basically band-aided the system until we ran out of band-aids.
So. I'll move approval.
Second.
Thank you, Dave. Bill, any other questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you.
We'll now turn to the county manager's report. Craig, what updates do you have for us tonight?
A couple of things tonight. First, wanted to talk a little bit about the consolidation of DSS and Health Department. And in your agenda packets, you do have a staffing analysis. We also looked at mandated versus non-mandated cost. And as you can see, our funding has gone down since the 2009 fiscal year. DSS has decreased about 12.7%. We've also reduced positions, and if you look at the health department, the county funding over that time also has decreased about 5.1%. But again, it blows a list of the mandated and non-mandate, or the non-mandated programs that we do provide in both departments. So if there's any questions on that. We're still trying to look at cost savings. With the possible consolidation, and I think those cost savings are going to be we'll see over time, but at this point it's been kind of difficult to come up with those cost savings, but we're still working on it. And the second page is talking about our personnel policy, the differences that between the Office of State Personnel, which the Health Department and Department of Social Services are under now, and then changes we would possibly have to make if they fell under the county's personnel policy. But first, I do want to thank Brian's been the manager's office point person on this, and for all the work that he's done, but also Barry and Susan and their department for getting all this information together. It's been a very large task, but it's one that's gone very smoothly, and I think it has helped us look at things a little bit differently as we move forward. As we've talked about before, there's a lot of different options on how to do a consolidated or a board-driven model. And what we're looking from this board is a direction. There's about four different models that you could look at. If you include not doing anything as a model, you know, there's four different models. There's going to be some things that we have to get clarification from. There's some Office of State Personnel that I think we've got to get clarification on. There's board membership, there's some public hearing requirements. And so what we're looking for from staff is we're looking from a direction from the board. If there is one model that you like, to give us that direction, so we're not taking the shotgun approach and looking at four different models, is that we're looking at one that we can put our focus on and get you the information that you would like for us to have, or information that you would like. If any questions from that, if the board is okay, I can go ahead and start kind of going over the options and where we're at today, and hopefully we can ask or answer any questions, and Brian or Clyde, if I miss something, please jump in as well. Again, what you have in front of you is this is how we look today. You have a board of commissioners, but then you have a board of health and a board of social services. Those two boards are appointed by the board of commissioners and for specific terms, and then you have the county health department under that and the County Department of Social Services under that, and they are separate agencies. Part of county, because we do fund their budget, we do appoint their boards, but they are separate agencies of the county. They're not departments. We do not have direct authority over personnel. That is done at that board level, the governing board level of the Board of Health and Board of Social Services. So that is the way we have it today.
We don't really appoint all the social service board.
Some are mandated.
Some out of state, I think, isn't it?
Social Services Commission appoints two, you appoint
right.
two, and then the fifth is appointed by the fourth board membership.
And again, a lot of options that you'll see there's still clarification that we need to get to make sure. And again, that's why we're asking if there is a direction for one of these options, we can focus on that option. Option one would be basically to abolish the current Board of Health and the Board of Social Services. And then the County Board of Commissioners would become that board. You would still have a separate Department of Social Services and a separate local health department. And under this option, they're not combined as departments. They're still treated as separate agencies. But under this model, the board hires and terminates the agency director. Boards may delegate supervision of those two directors to the county manager. But again, as part of this, even though the Board of County Commissioners would serve as the board, you still have to have a separate health department board that it serves more in an advisory capacity to the Board of Commissioners. In our initial understanding, and I've talked to Commissioner Smith, that there's some concern about the State Personnel Act being mandatory or not mandatory. It's not clear. Is that a fair way to say it?
Well, I don't think there's any authority for it at all. And I've been over the statute right thoroughly, and I talked with the county attorney about it also. Two of the options, well, I don't even count the option of keeping it the same, so that we'll get down to three options.
Yes,
two of the options say that it's, I've forgotten what the word is, optional.
Yes, sir.
And then the third one, this one, is it says that it's mandatory, but there's nothing in the statute that says employees are subject to this. PA is mandatory at all. In fact, I think it's just, as I've told you, and I think I've told the county attorney, I think it's just a misprint, or they wouldn't put down exactly correctly. I think the intent of the legislature on this amendment of this statute was that all three options would be about the same as far as, would be the same as employees. If not, you look at it and it just doesn't read logically. I'm sorry, it does not do that. And I think we have to look to the intent of the legislature. In fact, the only key paragraph in the statute says local employees who serve as staff of a consolidated county human services agency. And I think that is a catch-all phrase that the legislature used for all three options. I don't think they meant to exclude option one at all. And are subject to county personnel policies and ordinances only, and are not subject to the provisions of the State Personnel Act, unless the County Board of Commissioners elects to subject local employees to the provisions of that act. And it's my feeling, if you read the whole paragraph, that's exactly what the legislature intended to be.
And I'm not disagreeing with that.
No, we don't have any disagreement on it. I think it's just a matter of interpreting what the law says.
And that's where we, you know, again, we're still in kind of the throes of this and trying to get clarification on a lot of these issues as well. And that's, you know, we want to bring these issues to your attention that I think, as Commissioner Smith said, the legislature sometimes don't even know what they want. So
I think they knew what they wanted, but they just didn't get it down
right. Yes, sir.
And I think that's the only discrepancy in either of the three options that you presented to us.
Yes, sir. Now, if there's any questions, and again, this would still keep a separate Department of Social Services and a separate Department of Health. But again, the Board of Commissioners would serve as the board.
You're talking about this is number one?
Yes, sir. This is number one. And an advisory board would have to be appointed for the health department.
Mm-hmm. Could we keep the same one?
I'm not sure what the makeup, but my guess is probably the same. Yeah, my guess
the structure would have to stay the same with the same.
Okay, the same requirements from.
But they only advise us.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Okay. Okay. That is option one. All right. This is option two. This would be a consolidated human services board. You would basically take the DSS board and take the health department board and consolidate them into one board. So instead of the two boards we have now, we would have one. And that they would be over a quote-unquote consolidated human services agency, which would be a consolidated DSS and health department. Again, under this role, the manager does have hiring and firing authority over the consolidated human services director with input from that board. Again, that board, if
you with consent of that board, so that limits your authority to some extent.
Well, I think one of the things I asked, Wake County has this model, and I did call the county manager, David Cook, and his response back to me is he's had to hire a new director. And he did involve members of that consolidated board in the process, but he said it was his final decision on that. So, but again, this would look at consolidation, consolidation of the departments, consolidation of the board, and putting that under the personnel supervision of the county manager. Any questions on option two?
Yeah, I do have a question, Craig. On the second bullet point there, the consolidated human services director.
Right.
Okay. Is that, that's from the green block, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So appoints person with health director qualifications as what?
It would be very there's very specific requirements of what your health director should be, and that person would still have to be part of the agency and part of that consolidated, you know, and serving that role, even though that person may not be the head of the consolidated agency, there would still be a role for the health director in the organizational structure. He would still, you'd still have to have somebody with those qualifications to oversee the health department side of it.
Plus, the way I look at it, you're going to have to hire a director to run the entire board, Consolidated Human Services Board. Didn't you say that's what Wake County finally did?
They have a separate direct. I don't know if they took Wake County has done it for a while. I'm not sure if they took maybe the existing DSS director when they made the change and then made that the consolidated director. So I'm not sure exactly how that is, but I can get that information as well.
Well, I mean, I think Dave's question is, what's the relationship between our board and the consolidated human services board in option two? And whoever heads that up, is that an additional person that the county's funding, or is that one of the existing staff?
It could be. And again, we've not gone that far down the road in looking at staffing for, you know, the different options. And that's kind of where we were trying to get focus on one option and then be able to come back to you with an organizational structure. So, but again, that board, the Consolidated Human Services Board would be appointed by the Board of Commissioners. But where it's different now is, again, one board, one agency, and the director would then be fall under the direction of the county manager, where it's not now, where those positions fall under the health department board or the DSS board.
Okay, but on that second bullet, Consolidated Human Services Agency Director appoints the person with the health director qualifications. Compared to our current structure, that director would appoint or basically hire the public health
well,
director?
Well, it will be just like in any department. You know, if that person in the organizational structure was second or third in command, the department head would have that responsibility of filling the positions under them, since it is a consolidated department. Just making sure, though, that that person, whoever was over the health department functions, met those qualifications.
But the day-to-day operations are going to be supervised by the Consolidated Human Services Board and not the county commissioners.
Yes,
county commissioners are going to have very little say-so over what that super board does, right?
The influence that the Board of Commissioners would have, since
who we appoint
is who you appoint, and also since the head of that agency would report to the county manager, who reports directly back to the board, you know, that there is also some input there as well.
So there is going to have to be a head of the agency, and whether you or whoever decides who the director for that is going to be, are they going to keep the director of social services and the health director under them?
And again, that goes back to looking at the organizational chart. It is how we would organize a consolidated agency as far as we haven't done that yet.
Well, maybe this would be the time for you to kind of, or Brian, to lay out to all of us. You know, I've got my ideas of the advantages and disadvantages of doing this, but legislation was passed with the intent that this is allowed. If it is allowed, what benefits accrue to the county? What benefits accrue to these current two agencies?
I think part of the benefits, and Brian, or please jump in, is if you do look at a consolidated agency, it does put everybody under one roof, and hopefully you have some economies of scale in working on systems and working on, you know, it's not separate. It's not a separate agency. We're not health department, even though I think our health department and DSS work well together. And I think they coordinate their resources as well as they can. By being under one umbrella, sometimes it does say, you know, hey, we're all in this together. This is, you know, we're all under one agency. We're not separate anymore. So I think there's some economies of scales there that benefit. I think, you know, and again, right now the positions are responsible to the boards. They're not responsible directly to county manager, even though we have a very good working relationship with both Susan and Barry and her staff. There is not that direct relationship that this would allow.
To me, this second option is, as I said before, a super board that would have a budget of well over $35 million and just absolutely too much power, I think. But go ahead.
Oh.
Well, what would that board do in terms of, you mentioned, Brian had mentioned appeals and the analysis of some...
Do everything that they're doing now as far as appeals and environmental health issues and complaints. So that board would handle those issues.
And county management would primarily be involved in obviously the hiring of the director, budget, HR, purchasing. Help me.
Yes. Again, you know, there's a lot of economies of scale, and again, once we get into it, looking at IT, looking at you know, simple functions and where we could have some cost savings, hopefully. You know, again, at this point, we've not done a complete organizational study at this time.
I'm just trying to equate it to the existing department. So from the board, our board's perspective, at budget time, you would bring to us the budget request of that department.
Well, it's
that,
very...
That wouldn't go to the Human Services Board. That would come to county manager.
Well, it does go to the Human Services or DSS board or to the Health Department board now, you know, and they pass it on up. It would still go through, you know, the same scrutiny as it does now. You know, we scrutinize the DSS and Health Department boards just like we do any other department. We scrutinize funding levels, we scrutinize, you know, employees, we scrutinize workloads. We look at all those different things in trying to formulate a budget. Any?
Three.
Oh, go for, yes, sir. I'm sorry. Option three. This would have the Board of Commissioners as the Consolidated Human Services Board. This would have a Consolidated Human Services Agency. Again, if you look at the difference between option, and again, this is something Commissioner Smith and I were talking about earlier about the State Personnel Act. In one way of reading it, it says under option one it's mandatory. In option three, it says it's optional. You know, so there's some clarification. We're still trying to get on that. But what this would be, which is different from option three versus option one, is the Board of Commissioners would still serve as the board and do all the appeals and things that the DSS and Health Department does now. But instead of still having two separate agencies, it would be consolidated into one agency. But again, also under this, the manager does have hiring and firing of consolidated services or the human services director with board approval or consent.
Okay, can you compare option two to how we're currently structured from a practical day-to-day management standpoint?
Option two, again, would be instead of two boards, it would be one board. Option two would have the DSS director or the director of the Consolidated Human Services report directly to the manager. Right now, the board has the authority of hiring and firing. Under option two, that would fall back with the manager, and again, it would be consent. And then option two also is looking at true consolidation and putting the department agencies together.
So you can't tell if you can do away with their personnel departments and their finance departments.
We have started to look at that, and there's some very specific things that some of their departments do that may cross over, but there's a lot of things that they don't do that cross over, especially in the social services end. So we're starting to look at that now. But again, if it was two separate agencies, you wouldn't have that consolidation.
Can you put option two back on the screen? Really, you're saying the agency reports directly to the board and delegated to the county manager, and it's kind of a dotted line then to the Consolidated Human Services Board. Is that correct? I mean, I know that's not what you have, but the way you're describing it, if they're providing guidance and doing the appeals and the other support, but the agency itself is a department of the county reporting to the county manager,
right?
That's where the direct line ends,
right?
Not?
That's where the direct line, and you know, for Brian and I had this conversation today, you know, for right or wrong, we've not attended DSS or health department meetings. If this did become a consolidated, you know, service where the manager's department had direct control, one of us would be at those board meetings of the consolidated board. You know, so again, this is very fluid right now. We're still, there's a lot of things we would have to work through. And that's why, you know, if the board not trying to push you, but looking for a direction on one option so we can start working towards that end goal.
But attending the board meetings under option two, there's just one board.
Right.
Well, I'm on both boards. And, you know, I think we need to leave it like it is, so that's my opinion.
Let me read to the statute here as to what we should do, I think, now. It says the Board of County Commissioners may exercise the power and authority herein conferred, which we're talking about here, only after a public hearing held by said board pursuant to 30 days notice of said public hearing. And to me, what that means is this board needs to make a decision as to whether we want to make a change or not, and not particularly pick one of the three options, but have the public hearing and let the public come and speak if they want to about what they think and how they feel and what which one they prefer, and then the board decides at that time.
Is that what it says we have to do?
That's the way I read it. County attorney,
what's your thoughts?
I agree with Commissioner Smith. You have to have a public hearing. You have to have 30 days notice.
And that way we're going to have a lot more time to get more information on all three.
Well,
we're looking at the first or second meeting in May now because of the 30-day notice. We won't be able to get it in May.
I think we need to set a public hearing.
And you have some other questions about interpretation that maybe Clyde can look at as well?
Yeah, I've talked with Clyde on some of them, and I talked with the manager also, yeah.
Okay. Then a motion would be in order
to table it until the
and to schedule.
Let's set a public hearing.
Yeah, set a date of a public hearing. It's got to be within 30 days?
No, you got to have 30 days.
At least 30
days.
Right. Yeah. And are you making that motion?
Yes, I'm making it.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion or questions? Is that workable for county staff?
That is workable.
What's magic about July 1?
Well, there's nothing magic. I thought there was, and again, if I was wrong, budget starts July.
No, those are targets.
Yeah, that's a target. There's nothing says that it has to be by July 1.
It may take 6 months to get this straightened out. It may take a year to get it straightened out. But we've got to get started, I think, and get some things done. So we're spinning our wheels here, and if we go ahead and set the public hearing, we've got at least 30 days.
Right. Well, and again, that there are some specific questions that Commissioner Smith had about the State Personnel Act that we need resolved and answers to. I think there's another additional questions that, and I'm sorry, I can't remember right now, that we need clarification on. If the board is agreeable to this, is the only and concern that I have is, what else would you need from us at this point, moving forward with the three options? You know, do we want to wait till after the public hearing, decide on one of those options at the public hearing, and then move from there?
Yeah,
if I could ask the board, that would make it real, so I'm not working on three different options that we would wait for.
But I think the chairman and I have raised some questions,
yes, sir,
that you can get the input.
Yes, sir. Those questions we can answer within the week.
Otherwise, it would be on the night of the public hearing that we would be,
right,
I think, make a decision.
And then a decision is made on which option.
Yeah.
And then from that point, we can start working on timelines. We can start working on organization. That would make my life simple, simpler, instead of looking at you know, different organizational structures for three different options.
And we have a motion. Did you second?
Second.
And the only other thing is, and you don't have to wait till the public hearing to give us those updates, like at the next meeting.
Right.
If you learn.
Oh no. We'll work on those ASAP.
Give us updates,
yes, sir.
As you learn.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right.
Mr. Chair, what is the date of the public hearing?
Well, at least 30 days, it would have to be.
I think the clerk said
May 20th is the
second meeting.
That'd be perfect.
And that's the night meeting as well.
It's going to be after April 18th.
That means the clerk will have to get it into a newspaper within the next week or 10 days, right?
You work with that? May 18th, whatever it is. Is that Monday?
May 20th, she said.
I'm sorry, Tori, what was the date?
May 20th.
May 20th.
That's the second meeting.
All right. Does that work, everybody? So can you amend your motion to add the date?
Yeah, the public hearing will be May 20th.
Okay, and second?
Second.
Other questions, discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, thank you. Thank you, Greg. I know y'all are doing a lot of work.
Well, and again, Brian has done a yeoman's job on this, and I appreciate the work Barry and Susan has to get us to the information where we're at now. But again, thank you to staff. Do have just a couple dates I want to mention to you. Make sure you got on your calendar. The joint city-county meeting hosted by Green Level is this Thursday night, March 21st at 6:30 p.m. at the Ramada in Burlington.
We tied up for that.
So, the Republican convention is that same day.
Right.
Same time. So,
I'll come and eat your steak for you. I'll eat your steak for you. So.
That's a fair enough deal.
Republicans are cheap, Greg. They don't have anything.
the next one is a reminder of March 24th, Sunday, March 24th, beginning at 2 p.m. at Providence Church in Graham. It is the historic celebration of the Providence Church, but also the celebration of the birth of Alamance County. So we will have a bunch of departments there with booze, and again, I appreciate Brian.
Did you say booze?
That's what I heard.
I said booze.
Oh.
It's my Eastern North Carolina. It's my Eastern North Carolina accent. So, I'm starting to sweat. But that'll begin at 2 o'clock on the 24th, Sunday the 24th. Yes, sir. And then at 3, the unveiling of the portraits of the judges will be at the historic courthouse. So kind of a busy afternoon on the 24th. And also to remind you of our budget workshop, April 15th at 9 a.m. at May Memorial.
Farm Bureau has a meeting, luncheon meeting.
They do. April 11th.
Oh, it's in April?
Yes, sir.
Oh. I forget when I write them down.
Well, while we're on the subject of dates, while everybody's still here, Bill Ashton and I had the opportunity to visit with the Guilford County Commissioner, part of the Guilford County Commissioners last week to carry on the discussion of the Alamance-Guilford line situation. And I want, and please help me, Bill, but I'd like everybody to know, we had talked about getting together for a big meeting with everybody, and there was some resistance, reluctance, waste of time type thing. So I contacted the chair, and the chair invited Bill and myself over. We met with her and also, I guess, the commission rep.
Protective district.
They're in districts and at large. And then they had a third commissioner there. They have a total of 9, so that was easy to do.
Thor was invited, but only 3 showed up.
And we met also with their interim manager, who is actually their HR director. And basically, we just told the story of what we had presented to the folks in Orange County, but we also made it clear that when we had that vote for what we called the zigzag approach, that it was not a unanimous vote, that our vote was 4-1, and that all we were asking Guilford to do was to consider one way or the other so we can resolve this thing. We've had issues that we've discussed in here, it's not fair to the property owners. So they actually invited us to come to their work session, which is this Thursday, where all we're going to do is lay out how we did the situation in Alamance Orange, what the geodetic choice would be, which their attorney, Mark Payne, is certainly aware of and has worked with Clyde, and wait for direction from them. And as Bill and I have told everybody, it's really in their court. We'd like to get this resolved and probably would make a recommendation to this board to go whichever way they lean. So they're going to learn this Thursday. They've got a full board meeting following. They may take a vote on it. If they do, Craig, I'd like for it to come back to this board at the next meeting.
Yes, sir.
Is that
That's pretty much the way it went. Yeah.
And very cordial meeting, very nice, and they just want to learn, but...
They're still trying to learn also.
They are. So that's where that stands. And then the other thing is, in front of us, it's not on the agenda, but we've got several reports that are worth reading. One is the 2012 Child Healthy Report Card. One is a statistical update from MJ, the public library, and we also have the statistics from the public school forum that measure all the counties in North Carolina. One of the things that focuses on is a county's relative ability to pay versus their actual effort to pay. And I'm sure we'll be looking at that a little bit more closely as we go into the budget season. So with that said, are there any other dates or announcements? I want to do that before we lose part of our crowd here. If not, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143-318.11A6, to consider the performance of an employee. Again, as we have been talking with the three individuals that report directly to this board, the county manager, the county attorney, and the tax administrator, we're completing the process of the feedback from our county attorney. Glad I'll just tell the group, there's no raise tonight. But we are encouraging feedback, and then we will have our third and final discussion at the second April meeting with Jeremy as the tax administrator. So that's what this is about. I made the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor say aye. Mm-hmm. Any opposed?
Can we have the commissioner's comments before we go into this?
Sure. Would you like to do that?
Yeah, I have an issue I'd like to bring up. And I was looking at the first 6 months report, which the manager gave me, and the projection, I think the first 6 months, we were something like $100,000 under budget, right? And projecting maybe $180,000 or $90,000 for the entire year. In my opinion, that is too close to call, and I think the county needs to consider some rather stringent moves at this time for the last quarter, at least, of our budget session. And I would suggest to this board that we put a freeze on travel, a freeze on hiring, and a freeze on purchasing for those 3 months, because that $100,000 the first 6 months did not include any contributions to the fund balance at all. And I think we need to try to save as much money as we can to hopefully add something to the fund balance this year, if we possibly can. And it's a necessary evil that we just can't spend what we want to spend.
I thought your original projection was $180,000 to the good.
It is, but it's razor thin. It is razor thin.
I'll second David's motion.
Is there a discussion?
I don't like the freeze, but.
Well, you got another suggestion on how in the world we can save some money? I mean, you know, departments are going to have to reuse paper clips and make some changes and do some saving. That's all I'm saying.
What steps are you involved in now?
We have with departments, we give them an update every month of budget and where they're at, and we harp on that consistently. But we have not gone to the level yet of putting those hard freezes.
I mean, I think there are some things that just have to be bought at times, because, like I said, I've worked in several of the agencies, and I think it's something that if you want to do it next time, then fine, but I think it's just springing it on them right now. I mean, I think they, you know, they need a little heads up for it. So.
Well, it's human nature that when you get toward the end of your budget, you're going to spend what you possibly can. And mm-hmm. The travel freeze certainly would not apply to emergency services like the sheriff and EMS, but I don't see any reason in the world for 3 months we can't cut spending. It's been done before, and we saved a lot of money.
I guess I have a point of clarification, Clyde. motion's made and there's a second and there's a vote and there's a tie vote with the commissioner not here,
then it doesn't pass.
And then the second thing I would say, Craig, if it doesn't pass, following up on what Commissioner Massey said, maybe you could bring an update at the first April meeting with a plan that could address what Commissioner Smith is talking about if this does not pass.
Yes, sir.
So we do have a motion. We do have a second. Any other questions, discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
And I'll say no. But I think the idea is there is good. I agree with Linda. Mm-hmm. I hate to spring it on without some county analysis and input.
What we will do is we will get with department heads this week and tell them of the concern, and we will look at everything we can on travel, open positions, those type things, and bring you back a plan.
Any other comments before we go into closed session? We do have a motion and a second. We've already approved that. If not, we'll go into closed session with Clyde.